Motivational Interviewing. Motivational Interviewing by Miller and Rolnick defines the approach as a facilitating client-centered directive method for enhancing intrinsic motivation to change by exploring and resolving ambivalence. To dip more deeply into that approach, let's take a differentiated look on the central aspects of this definition. Interviewing has to be client-centered. Using an empathetic style of interaction is a fundamental characteristic of motivational interviewing. This means expressing acceptance toward your client, even if you feel that their behaviors are harming them. You don't need to condone their behavior or agree. Just accept. Acceptance shows your willingness to listen, understand, and to respect your client as a human being. Directive. Although the coach will be acting in a way that expresses acceptance of the client's behavior, they will be also directing them towards change. This will be achieved by encouraging change talk, which will be described later. Enhancing intrinsic motivation. One goal of motivational interviewing is to increase a client's internal motivation for change. Enhancing motivation will also require your client to build confidence in their ability to make changes. Exploring and resolving ambivalence. Ambivalence refers to a person's mixed feelings about change. Motivation can be increased by exploring and resolving these feelings of ambivalence. You will use reflection, empathy, and so on to help your client to understand their ambivalence better while directing them toward a solution. Directing a client toward change talk will help them to overcome ambivalence. Change talk occurs when a client discusses the changes they would like to make in a positive light, such as identifying the benefits of quitting a harmful drug. In the following, there are several techniques described to help with this process. First, the motivation ruler. Ask your client to describe how motivated they are to make a change on a scale of 1 to 10. At 1, they have no motivation to change, and at 10, they have no doubt they are wanting to change. It can be helpful to present them with a ruler to help them visualize the task. After the client responds, even if their number is low, you can ask why it is not lower. Why did they choose 4 instead of 1? If the client says why they want to have some motivation for change rather than none at all, will lead them to speak in favor of making the change. As a follow-up question, you can ask, how could we move from a 4 to a 6 on the ruler? Second technique, asking about extremes. Try asking hypothetical questions about the best or the worst case scenarios. Here's an example. If you continue using drugs, what's the worst that could happen to you over the next 5 years? Next technique, exploring values. Assist the client in identifying and exploring their values to better understand which ones they are living up to and which they are failing. It will be important to keep in mind that your values might differ from the values of your clients. Continuing change talk. When a client begins to use change talk, it is the coach's role to make sure it continues. This can be achieved in a number of ways. You could ask for more detail. In what ways will you feel better if you quit smoking, for example? Reflect the change talk. You're really starting to consider quitting cigarettes for good? affirm change talk with body language. You may nod or you may shake your head in agreement. You're making a good point. The more time a client spends engaging in change talk, the more likely they're actually to make the change. Rolling with resistance. Resistance in counseling refers to a client's behavior in opposition to making desired changes. A common response to resistance creates a situation where the client and the coach are opposed to one another. When using motivational interviewing, the client will attempt to roll with the client's resistance. This means instead of engaging in an argument, you will continue to make sure that the client feels heard through the use of reflections. During periods of resistance, you can also use several different reflection techniques to continue moving the conversation forward. You can use amplified reflection. Reflect the client's statement in an exaggerated form, but be careful not to cross the line into sarcasm or irony. Reframing. Create a new and more positive interpretation of events that have been described by the client. Example. The client says, "My parents are trying to get rid of me. That's why they want me to go to rehab." Coach. "It sounds like your parents are doing their best to help, but they've made some mistakes along the way. They aren't sure how to help you without hurting you." Double-sided reflection. Reflect the client's statement, but also add information that they have previously shared in this country to their current resistance. Client. "I don't want to quit drinking. It just isn't a problem for me." Answer of the coach. "You don't feel that drinking is a big enough problem for you to worry about, except for those times, like you shared last week, when you got really angry at your family." Once someone has made the decision to change, it will be necessary to make sure they have the confidence to do so. Ask open questions about change. Help your client envision themselves making the desired change by asking open questions. Some examples are: what will be the first step to making this change? What might trip you up to, and how can you deal with that problem? Even if it's tough, what might help you to be successful? Second, identifying personal strength. Spend time discussing a client's strengths, especially those that will help them make the change. If your client has difficulties generating their own strengths, try to lead them into the right direction while still encouraging them to be the one to generate the answers. Keep the conversation going by asking the client to elaborate when they are able to come up with some strengths. Discuss past success. Search for examples of times when the client has made positive changes that they are proud of. Gather information such as what has worked, what motivated them, and what skills they used to be successful. Again, keep the conversation going by asking for elaboration. Strengthen the commitment to change. At some point, you will recognize that your client has decided to change and he or she has built the confidence to do so. Indications for a client reaching this point are decreased resistance, frequent change talk, experimenting with the change, or asking questions about how to make the change. During this final stage of treatment, it will be important to maintain your client-centered approach. At this point, you will want to collaborate with the client to create a change plan. Develop goals. Work with your client to create clear goals for change. Keep in mind that you will have to help the client finding his or her own goals. Create a plan. Next, help the client generate his or her own ideas or provide them with options to choose between. Strategies for change should include specific actions such as avoiding people who trigger the unwanted behavior or reaching out to social support when necessary. Also, consider obstacles and how they can be managed. And last but not least, commit to the plan. Finally, you want to make sure the client has bought into the plan. If the client doesn't feel ready, don't force them. Ask questions about where there are problems and tweak the plan as necessary. If possible, it can be helpful to have your client share the plan with an important loved one to enhance their commitment and to garner social support. Once your client has agreed to change, the process of motivational interviewing has been completed. Further sessions can be used to check in, tweak the change plan when there are difficulties, and maintaining motivations with Change Talk.